quickly as we see SKT banning out Orianna, Thresh, and Renekton, three champions that Gaming Gear really have been relying on.
Yeah, the one thing they did let through is the Sona, which Gaming Gear put a very high priority on. They did take away, in exchange for letting them have the Sona, they've taken away that Renekton for the top lane from NBS, though. Now,
there's a lot of cheering from the crowd here as we switch through the likes of Alistar, Tryndamere, Brand. Let's not forget, Gaming Gear have played Tryndamere in the wildcard tournament.
Yeah, but here, they've played pretty much the same things. It's been Jarvan, Renekton, and Thresh as their core three, and then a Trinity Force AD and an Assassin mid for Mazarin so far. So Gaming Gear already changing it up. Because the Renekton was banned out, they pulled in the Aatrox. I finally get to cast an Aatrox game, but I think it will be a top lane Aatrox, which is a little bit less exciting. Because I love jungle.
We saw a little smile from Faker there as he trolled the crowd with that brand hanging in there. But that was switched out in the end to the Ezreal. Mordekaiser, that's not going to happen. We should talk about SKT. Zyra, Shen, Ezreal picked up for them.
Okay, so they have the disengage there from Zyra. Very, very popular support nowadays. Sona still be left being left up for Gaming Gear. I think they'll lock that in as their last support. But with the Shen as well, they do have that global pressure that's going to come from the top lane.
So, other side, Gragas, a big pick for Mazarin, and probably his second champion to really go to after Orianna, which of course was banned out here by SKT T1. And that Sona, as you said, probably 100% likelihood of that getting locked in here at this stage. Pretty familiar lineup for Gaming Gear.
Yeah, let's talk about this Gragas on Mazarin, because this is actually a very big pick for them. Orianna's been banned out the whole time. He had a lot of game-changing plays on Orianna, but Gragas was his second favorite champion at Gamescom. He got a Baron steal that basically won them the game. He gets picks in the late game. He's very, very accurate with that usually risky ultimate from Gragas. If you miss the Gragas ultimate, we've already seen teams, some of the Korean teams, you know, like Ozone, if you miss that combo, then Gragas is a very, very weak mid laner. But Mazarin, usually on point with those, and that's where a lot of Gaming Gear success comes from.
Right now, SKT T1 got to be picking up the Fizz here for Faker in the mid, and a Vi. Teemo, right. I'm not going there.
I'm excited for a Faker Fizz, because Fizz is a flashy champion. You can pull out some very spectacular moves, and Faker is definitely the man that you want to put that champion in front of.
So cycling through the likes of Victor in there as well.
This guy, the crowd is even like, more excited than me for these interesting picks.
In the end though, this Zac, probably a likely choice for MBS. I'm quite surprised that Jarvan has not even been touched here, because Gaming Gear, they've played two games, both of them with Jarvan in the jungle. SK Telecom have also had Jarvan in their game against OMG.
That's why I was expecting a top lane Aatrox here, because I was assuming that they would just lock in that Jarvan, but you're right, Gaming Gear making a lot more changes than we initially thought. And Corki is definitely an upgrade for them as far as Trinity Force ADs go. Shucks.
And there is the Jarvan, just as we thought from that one. So that will round out Gaming Gear's team, and I think a very strong team overall here. Very comfortable picks for them generally across the board.
So again, they have that same mid-game AoE damage that comes from the bottom lane. Corki with all the missiles and Sona's Flash Crescendo ability gives them a nice control over the mid line, where the game-changing plays, really, like we said, are going to come from that Mazarin, the long-range Gragas ultimates. They're going to hope to split up this SKT team. Meanwhile, SKT on the other side, they're looking for the Vi-Fizz combo. That means somebody's dead right there.
Yeah, and, well, for Gaming Gear, they've got to try and avoid that one, but usually when you see Vi coming, it's kind of too late. You need to predict where Vi's coming. That's a real key point to that one. So it's two very strong teams here on, you know, very different stages of their whole tournament, I'd say. Obviously, SKT T1 not having the best start to things. They're losing out there to OMG. On the other side, for Gaming Gear, they're rock bottom right now, and hopefully this day off that they had yesterday, they've really managed to group and talk about things and get over what I think were a lot of nerves as well for them.
They don't seem too down, though. It seems like they're in good spirits right now. Another thing that goes in with that Vi and Fizz, by the way, is going to be a Shen, which you will see coming, but it's going to be devastating when they get to the back line.
Well, then, let's have a look then at you guys and what you've been thinking about this one. Something tells me it's not going to be too close. LoliSports.com says 93% of you believe in SKT to win this one. All the analysts said SKT as well. I guess I'm going to have to go with Gaming Gear just to be the possibly one person in the world, along with the other seven that are right.
All right, guys, write that one down. Joe is for Gaming Gear here. Let's keep track of his scores.
That doesn't count onto the caster's total. I'll just throw that out there right now. So let's get into game then. It is SK Telecom T1 versus Gaming Gear. An incredible matchup. We're hoping SKT, they could be angry coming into today's play after that ropey game against OMG, though.
And Gaming Gear, they have had very, you know, sporadic spots of brilliance. In the mid-game, they've had some team fights where they win when they're already down by like 10K gold, yet they still come out ahead in one of those later game team fights. So they do have the ability to even win after they're already behind. So if they can get off to a good start, then, you know, maybe you and that 7% of the fans could show everybody that they put all their eggs in this SKT basket erroneously.
I got you, 7%. We're good for this one. Right now, Gaming Gear are down on the bottom side of SKT's jungle. SKT were up in the top side of Gaming Gear's jungle. See that those wards closely identical on both sides of the map. One difference, however, is that Gaming Gear already had a ward there by red and spotted them moving around.
So they will have knowledge, but you're right. Those are the sort of classic dual red side invades. I mean, SKT1 are the ones that have the lane ward, so they'll see Aatrox going up top. And Aatrox as the top laner, the reason that Wicked really likes him so much, because you can make use of that passive very early, go for a turret dive and a flashy kill early. And then, once you have your ultimate, popping that with the extra attack speed you get from charging up Bloodwell means he's a beast at taking down turrets if ever left alone.
So there's a red buff taken from Alanir, and a very quick one at that, using his smite here to get that one away, actually leaving up part of the camp as well. So Bengi's going to come around and have to reset that one a little bit later on.
And because of that Tribush ward, they saw the exit of Alanir out of the jungle, so Bengi's not wasting much time here. He's not going to even go check his red, knows that it was stolen away, and he will answer here with the Gaming Gear red.
So look at that statistic there for Mazarin. 100% win rate with Gragas from that wild card tournament. We'll see if that can continue today. Certainly, I think a different caliber of opponents that he's going up against. It's Faker in the middle, after all.
Faker's definitely a different caliber. Maybe be in his own league, even. I don't know how many people can stack up against him. He will be going up against Reginald later in the day, so he has not faced all of the international mids.
We'll see about that one. I'm sure Reggie's really excited about that one as well.
He actually is really excited. He's not super confident, but he's very excited.
Excited, at least. So we saw there a bit of counter-jungling going on. When I say a bit, I mean really a lot, actually.
Yeah.
We've got the entire time Bengi on the top side of the Gaming Gear jungle. Alanir is down on the bottom side, and he's actually moving down now to that bottom side of this bottom lane. So we'll see if he can actually get in here. They've spotted him, though, from that Tribush ward.
Ooh, good flash there from MBS. Gets out of the Vault Breaker range from Bengi. And there was no, you know, late flash there from Bengi. You can actually Vault Breaker flash and still land that, but you have to instantly react. It's very, very difficult to do. Now Aatrox, with no flash, will have to worry. He does not have wards up top either. And with Alanir not backing yet, you know, he's not going to be able to supply wards for Aatrox.
So this mid lane then, Mazarin on Gragas versus Faker on Fizz. And Mazarin got a slight CS lead, got actually a level lead there. We saw him hitting level 4 that little bit earlier than what Faker's done. And Mazarin generally been good with this one, but Alanir right now is down in this bottom lane, hammering away on towards Piglet. They switch around. Deadly Brother going very, very low from this one. Piglet forced to flash away. Deadly Brother has managed to warp, but now they turn around. They're going in on towards Alanir. Are they going to be able to get across?
Flash.
Here is Bengi moving across. They've got a ward for Vision on towards Alanir. Right now, it looks like they might be able to get back to the turret. There's a Grasping Roots on Inspiro, and he does get back to safety.
That exchange right there just reminded me that Bengi or Piglet, actually, you know, he's running Ignite with the Ezreal. So he's definitely looking to Arcane Shift forward into the fights for cleanup, as opposed to backward. But Deadly Brother was the one, the AD carry right there, overextending a little bit. Almost cost him his life. But nobody goes down. SKT1 are able to shove the wave into a turret, which is going to allow some CS to be lost right there for Gaming Gear.
So Bengi on his way, and he's like, ah, look at that. Camp all up. Bad times. So, and we'll clear that one out. This top lane, despite that early pressure from Bengi, you know, MBS, no flash, but Aatrox's generally going to be that little bit safer with the ability to jump away, get his slows down, and have that passive for use if needs be.
Yeah, Bengi having to clear out those small lizards from the lizard camp means that he knows Alenir doesn't have the timer on his red, so I don't think that there will be a repeat invade from Alenir on the second respawn of that red. But Bengi's going to be aware of that, so they can actually take advantage of around the 7 minute mark. We've seen a lot of these Korean teams go for secondary invades on the buff spawns.
So Alenir just had a bit of a visit towards mid. Faker actually recalling from there, and he's going to come back into lane with double Doran's rings. Got himself some wards as well, so should be able to set things up for Bengi to actually get in there and have an impact.
Yeah, and like you said, we're coming up on that 7 minute mark. So with Faker timing his recall already at 6 minutes, he's going to be ready with that power spike of the dual Doran's rings, but he's also bought pink ward and green ward. Coming to clear out so much vision from that mid lane. You can see even Bengi as well as Ezreal doing their part buying these pink wards. They are going to spam vision in this bottom side, which is very dangerous for Gaming Gear.
Saw Mandu there, and Piglet taking a bit of a blast from Inspiro. Right now, Bengi is waiting inside of the tribe, but they're going to spot him. They've spotted him there coming around. Right, and in the end, they just back away. He uses his pink ward there so they can clear out that vision of that bottom lane. It's going to leave Gaming Gear now a little bit more conscious as to where they are positioned in that lane.
Interesting. So Bengi going bottom with the gank. He's able to tell that Gaming Gear have a ward in that side bush, because they started moving back only when Bengi got into vision of that river ward. He drops his pink up there to clear that one and allows Piglet to use his pink ward to clear side bush. So now Piglet and Pumandu have side bush control as well, which is very important for Zyra with a skill shot CC.
Well, the funny thing is he put his pink ward down on that top side bush, but there's a pink on the bottom side as well. They're kind of missing each other on that one. There's Bengi's statistics right now. For Vi, 100% win rate, certainly the kind of win rate that you don't mess around with. Esmandu putting down more damage. He's around about half HP himself, so they need to be careful up, not to go too far.
Up top, they've timed the flash here from MBS. It's about to run out, so Bengi's making moves up there, but they've already been able to fill in a ward, easily bypassed by Vi with the dash that she has. And MBS, he's got another 20 seconds left on his flash. He won't have it for the gank.
There is the taunt coming in. Where's MBS going? He's actually headed around the other side. Will pop his ultimate here. Jumps over towards that tri-bush. Already taking a good chunk of damage. Going through that turret. Is Faker going to come up to this one? You can see that Mazarine started to work his way down. And MBS, where's he going to go from here?
He could have gotten out if they had a mid ward for vision. But since Faker went to farm the Wraith camp, he thought Faker was coming to cut him off. And he burns his flash again. He wanted to burn his flash to try and not give up first blood and suicide the turrets right there, but he ends up doing both.
Mazarine there going to throw down the barrel, but Shen going to come into this one. Lands a taunt. Mazarine is a dead man. Faker picks that one up. Meanwhile, Inspiro goes down in the bottom lane. Mandu is low. Piglet's going to chase in here on towards Deadly Brother, who will have to Valkyrie back away towards that turret. Oh. Well, when it rains, it pours here. As Alenir now being troubled underneath the turret of his own. Faker tanking that one up. That'll switch off. He's going to go down. Alenir picks one up there, but that kills everywhere for SKT.
That was devastating for Gaming Gear all over the map. Aatrox dead, first blood. Aatrox passive down as well. Bengi's not done.
That's Deadly Brother. And he's going to go down for this one. Did manage to pick up Mandu in the process of that one, but Still, it's another one. Spread across the board. Look at the kills here. Two for Bengi, two for Faker, and a single one there on Piglet as well.
They have been able to trade there. Faker, because he used the damage coming down portion of his playful trickster, the trickster part, he got tower aggro and died. As well right there, Deadly Brother was able to answer, but even more important than the kills is all the CS and all the CS that Deadly Brother is going to lose by being dead.
So, MBS, no passive at this point in the game. No flash either that was used as he tried to escape a little bit earlier on, which leaves him very, very vulnerable in this top lane. We already saw Impact there giving him a good bit of damage back after Taunt comes in. So, things start to slow down somewhat. Let's have a look down the items. We've seen the AD carries almost a mirror image between the two, headed both up towards that Trinity Falls.
Yeah, that's no surprise. Both of these are the Trinity Force AD carries. I guess Kog'Maw's in there as well if you're Genja, or if you're Imp. Yeah, if you're Imp looking at Genja. Double Lift is not sold on those yet still, though.
So, across the map, we see already Boots some ability in there for Bengi. That's going to make him a little bit more dangerous as he runs quicker around the map. Picking up an Oracle here 10 minutes into the game.
Wow, that's a very, very ballsy pickup. A little bit less so with the changes to Oracles because it does persist through death now. I guess that just shows confidence that they want to be able to clear out and continue to have pressure on each lane.
Okay, Deadly Brother trying to put down Piglet here as we are going to see Stranglethorns coming in. There's a crescendo. Well, here comes Bengi from the side. They've not seen him. This could cost them. Deadly Brother surely going to be finished off. Bengi picks up another one. This will be a 2-for-1 in the end.
Right.
Pumandu did go down, but a 2-for-1 and two more kills for Bengi.
Okay, what it was Bengi was the one getting all the last hits. I forgot he was the one getting all the last hits. So the way that you exert your pressure as a jungler, if you're the one who gets all the last hits from your ganks, is that you get the mobility plus vision control of the Oracle's mobility boots combination, and that allows the first kills that your team gets to effectively pressure all lanes because your opponents don't know where the jungler is, so every single lane has to play careful or they go down just like that.
That's going to allow a dragon pickup here for SKT. We also saw move from Impact there, going between the inner and outer turrets in that top lane and stealing away that entire wave of minions. Faker actually did start to come down, by the way, to that bottom lane to see if he could get involved in a few more kills. In the end, though, it's Bengi who's soaking them all up.
Oh. Yep.
MBS and Impact here can have a bit of a fight with each other. Actually, Alanir is coming around the side as well. Impact pretty tanky already with that Sunfire Cape in there. He's not actually seen Alanir coming down, so this could be deadly as Jarvan does come around there. Impact down to below, half HP. He's going to try and stand United away, and he is going to get away. Wow, brilliant from Impact. Straight to base. Nice recall.
He's got a good shield down there, ready to buy. It is going to give them the tower pushing power that we talked about for Aatrox, and that combined with Jarvan will be enough for Gaming Gear to claim the first turret of the game.
First turret of the game for Gaming Gear there. Exactly, or not quite exactly 3,000 gold behind, but certainly close enough from that one. Bengi here going to get things kicked off on the blue buff. We'll see Faker come around and collect that one for himself. On the other side, Gaming Gear's blue buff is available for the taking as well for Mazarine.
Yeah, Bengi actually doing a very good job of showing why it's a good thing to let your junglers have the kills because they can visit all of the lanes and pressure the entire map because of the early roaming advantage that they have. And I also like that he's building into that spirit of the ancient golem on Vi because it will give him some HP to make him a bit more tanky and tenacity for him to allow him to get out. But cooldown reduction is really the best way to scale a jungle Vi as they contest for this blue here. There's enough pinks on Gaming Gear, though, that they are able to chase off SKT. Anyway, cooldown reduction is amazing for Vi because proccing her denting blows is the way you get so much damage.
Oh, that not great from Piglet, the aim on that one, but that turret going down very, very low there and will be finished off here along with that one as well. Piglet just trying to run as much of those minions down low as he can to prevent Deadly Brother getting the farm. Blue Buff actually is still up there, so in the end they decided not to fully challenge for that one unless they left the camp up somewhat. No, it is still there, so SKT going to come around. Gaming Gear looking like they're not quite so happy with giving it away, though.
Sona's definitely committing to this one. She's cutting off Bengi.
They're all coming around from this one. Bengi down to half. There's a strangle. Oh. Crescendo moved away from Mazarin's barrel. Will push Bengi away from danger. Mandu will die. And now Piglet is the one that's going to be in trouble. He's looking to get over the wall. Arcane Shift will do that. Inspiro goes down. Piglet actually sniping him off there with the Q. And I don't think they're done from this one. Bengi has come back into the fight. Deadly Brother going to get initiated onto. And that is another kill coming in. Actually did manage to finish off by. And now Faker is very, very low. He's still going though. He dives back in. Mazarin takes him down. Piglet flash away from Mazarin. Can he finish off Jarvan? Where's the slide? Oh, it doesn't matter. You finish it off there anyway. And wow, a turnaround, a 3-for-2 there in the end. Actually, it was a 4-for-2 really because Mandu died right at the very start.
This is a great, great foothold here for Gaming Gear. All started from Inspiro going around behind him. Even though he missed the crescendo and Mazarin's ultimate knocked away by, because of the positioning of Faker not rotating down, they had the early champion advantage here. We do get the... Okay, we'll just go back to the game because Alinir almost died. But yeah, they had the early champion advantage with one extra champion there. So even though the ultimate's not the hugest effect for Gaming Gear, they were able to focus their damage, take down Zyra very early, and come out ahead in that.
The fact that they're keeping up here in kills shows that Gaming Gear not ready to roll over and give up on this one by any stretch of the imagination. We've got the Dragon coming back up here in 1 minute and 40 seconds time as well. A distinct lack of wards, pink wards in particular, down there on that side, which I'm sure will change here in a few as we see that both Alania and Deadly Brother do have those pinks and Inspiro as well, as you maybe expect at this stage from the support. So they're certainly going to be able to get those pinks in position. Whether they're willing to fight there or not, it's a different matter.
It looks like they're definitely not going to give up this vision battle. And it shows because that's how, you know, they got that one little advantage in the last blue buff fight. The thing that's really scary here, though, is that SKT have hit the Lich Bane and Trinity Force spike at the exact same time here. So the Fizz and the Ezreal are extremely scary right now. And they also have Shen Stan United. So whatever move SKT wants to make on the map, it's going to be Gaming Gear having to play a little bit defensively and trying to answer this SKT aggression.
Well, that Dragon now less than a minute away. MBS, is he going to come down for this one? I certainly expect that a five-man presence is what Gaming Gear are going to be planning for in this one. There's a couple of wards there put down in middle just to keep vision up for SKT. They're actually going to lose their tower here in this mid lane. That's going to put Gaming Gear back in the lead when it comes to towers. And they're not done. They're still pushing.
They're getting very deep here. If SKT collapse, they have the advantage in this team fight. Deadly Brother still has 12,000 gold sitting on him. His Trinity Force has not been completed.
Oh, they've held up Inspiro there. And the grasping roots. Bengi moving forward. Shen can get involved as we see Ezreal come around this bottom side again. Gaming Gear actually headed down towards the Dragon position now. So they're going to set things up. Double pink ward, not ideal, but they're going to have that vision nonetheless. They start it off.
They're burning it down very quickly here. SKT have by ulti. There we go.
Bengi going to go in. They've gone for Deadly Brother. There's a crescendo coming back. Stranglethorns knocked two of them up. Inspiro, Alania, they're both dead in this one. There comes the barrel from Gragas very late in the fight. But look at Faker. He's gone low. Bengi picks up the Dragon right in the middle of everything. There's fight a little bit split. Double kill coming down in the end from Impact. Mazarin, the only one to walk away from it. With the Dragon going on to SKT, that's a lot of gold right there.
I think Gaming Gear should have taken their exit when they got away from their mid-push. Now Mazarin still pushed up here, and it is still dangerous. Even though Vi and Shen ultis are down, he's got to be careful.
Piglet taking a blast from Mazarin as well there in the end. Didn't fall, so that's all good from SKT's side of things. Look at the kill spread as well again after that one. 2-0-4 now on Impact Shen. 4-1-5 for Bengi, 2 kills in the mid for Faker, and a 5-1-4 Ezreal here for Piglet. That is scary. Here's a fight again.
All right, so because SKT had collapsed earlier, Gaming Gear try and get Dragon and chew this one out. There's a good double taunt after Shen comes in. It was a beautiful, as well, ultimate there from Zyra, knocking them up and controlling them. But the dragon still low means that even after all the kills that SKT got, they also got that dragon gold. So it was just an all-around win for SKT. And like I said, I think Gaming Gear bit off way too much because they had shoved down mid with very little resistance from SKT. They were fooled into thinking that they had the teamfight advantage and they could go for a dragon before basing for Deadly Brothers Trinity Force. Meanwhile, the already completed Trinity Force and Lich Bane on SKT, too much damage output.
Scary. MBS there, we saw taking so much damage from this Shen Spirit Visage, plus that Sunfire Cape in there for him right now as Faker pushes out that bottom lane as well. Top turret can't be contested either here for Gaming Gear. Two-man team able to pick that one up, and it looks like with those wards down, they're going to start to close in towards this mid lane.
With the amount of gold that SKT got from that last team fight around Dragon and the Dragon. Oh no, Mazarin's going for it.
Yeah, Chum the Wolves goes down, but...
good flash.
Yeah, gets really himself back towards safety there with that body slam plus the flash coming in. Faker though, he'll be happy with that. Your flash has gone down. I can keep pushing and next time around, you're not getting away.
Very, very dangerous now as Faker's already heading towards that hourglass for the extra rotation that he can get off. SKT1 right now, since they have control of the entire map, all I have to do is ward up the insides of the jungle here from Gaming Gear and CS all the lanes until they get the cooldowns back for another one of those decisive team fights.
Look at impact there over the top. In fact, forget that. Bengi coming around the side. Piglet was on the top as well. But this top lane, as I was mentioning, impact so, so very strong with this Shen at this stage. Done brilliantly with his taunts. Stan United's all been in the right place at the right time. Meanwhile, Faker, he's not even hidden himself in this bottom lane. He literally stood there and waited for Mazarin to start backing away. Goes in, he's now on the top side of the tower with the minions about to be taken down. And look at this, he's going to put the damage in onto Mazarin. There is Shen coming around. Didn't really need him in the end. Impact and Faker again teaming up for the kill. They're going to do a lot of damage to this turret. They might even stick around if Impact tanks it up for the kill.
Yeah, Fizz is great at getting down poke damage even as a melee under a turret because he has so much mobility. Another engage here from SKT1 on the other side of the map.
Alania sliding in from this one, puts a Cataclysm down. Will it be enough to save MBS though? He's trying to run away. Alania, is he going to pay his price for it? There's a crescendo from the side. They focus onto Deadly Brother. He will Valkyrie back to the tower. Piglet goes low. He's exhausted, but Bengi dives in. Also very, very low here. Inspiro takes a big hit, but in the end, no kills. But look at the bottom lane. They're pushing. They're on the in-hip.
That was 3 versus 4 up top, and SKT1 able to chase off Gaming Gear, allowing Faker plus Impact to take down the inhibitor turret. Their base has already been breached.
Base is breached. There we saw Inspiro, or didn't see really Inspiro going down, but I'm sure it wasn't that entertaining. Anyway, Bengi just getting straight in there. That's a 5-1-5 buy. Look at this, though. Deadly Brother goes straight in over the top with a Valkyrie, trying to chase down Piglet, who's already very slippy. There's a bomb landing. Mazarin is coming in there as well, but Ezreal, being Ezreal, will be able to escape.
Aatrox with his passive down is very vulnerable, and his dash is gone.
Yeah, 3 men on top of him right now. Chances of survival, 0. Faker gets that one. That's his 4th of the game right now. And one by one, they're falling here, and Faker's not done. He's looking for more. Actually, he'll back away and recall. Oh, in fact, the entire team of SKT are going to recall. They've got plenty of cash to spend right now.
This is going to be a very difficult defend for Gaming Gear. Because that inhibitor turret is already down, SKT1, they don't even need Stan United available. If they wanted to, they could just walk down that bottom lane and force the fight at inhibitor. They can also clear out vision on any area of the map that they want right now and force Gaming Gear to come to them.
It's an 11,000 gold lead that SKT are currently sitting on. Those wards that were put down by Gaming Gear are going to be just as quickly taken away from around the Baron pit. And SKT, they don't even need to risk Baron, but in the same token, they can fight Gaming Gear if they come anyway. This should be a win-win scenario for
them. It is actually very dangerous for Gaming Gear to get next to this Baron wall because Faker can jump right over.
And there we go. Faker dives in. Deadly Brother, he's going to fall. Inspiro getting hit by the True Shot Barrage will have to back away. I see Alania still in there trying to take down Mandu. But honestly, it's just a matter of time there as he gets knocked up. He gets taunted and finished off in the end by Piglet, who's now back on the killing spree at 6-1-5. SKT, they're going to go straight back into the Baron Pit. This should be theirs.
Yeah, when you get this far ahead, you have the money to clear out the vision around Baron to force your enemies to come to you. And then you also have the items to back up the picks when they come to the edge of the Baron Pit. Vi, Fizz, Ezreal, Shen all can get right over there. And Zyra can throw her snare over the side, which is what she needs to get down. So very, very tough place for Gaming Gear to be in. At least Gaming Gear is able to answer with the Constellation Dragon.
An added bonus, or a little bonus, I guess we could say, not really added, just to bolt on to what happened a little bit earlier on. SKT, well, that gold lead is 12,000, 12,500 even at this stage of the game. We see that that's actually the first dragon of this game for Gaming Gear. We'll see if they can do anything to stay in this one. Right now, though, they're going to be on the defensive. SKT T1, they've got Baron on, they've got a massive lead in both gold and obviously then translated into the items. This is a dangerous time for Gaming Gear.
And they've got a massive lead with a team that has a guaranteed engage. They've got Vi backed up by Shen and Fizz the Assassin. But like I said, very good at poking under turrets even though he's melee.
Wow, that's Alan here. Two-shot barrage comes across there. And just that combo almost taking him down. Faker moved in as well. Suddenly Dancer's back and all that time has managed to pick themselves a turret. Faker actually uses Zhonya's there, but Mazarin didn't explode the barrel till the Zhonya's actually came out and he took the damage for it anyway. Never mind, Faker goes back. Rest of SKT still hanging around there. Shen still pushing this bottom lane out. There's not a lot left in this game for Gaming Gear. And they continue to push as well there on the steps. And there's so much on the back foot here. And SKT, honestly, they're going to have to make a big mistake. Probably even more than one mistake at this stage.
Everyone always talks about, you know, the huge spikes that Fizz gets when he gets his Lich Bane. But it only gets scarier from there. Because like I said, that adds another AP ratio onto his kit. Which means the later the game gets, the more scary he gets. He can chunk people down even under turrets at this point and get out unscathed. It's so dangerous for Gaming Gear to even get close to him.
And there we see it. Alania almost hundreds, is it? Well, he's taken
but
down. In
it wasn't
end.
On screen, but that was basically what I was talking about.
All the rest of them going into this one, though. We see Inspiro going solo. He'll be finished off by Impact. The rest of them, they're underneath the two Nexus turrets right now. Impact not caring about that whatsoever. SKT have taken down two men. They may look to get their second inhibitor from this one. They probably will get it with this as well.
Shenzhen United here is going to protect Faker, but they won't actually re-engage on Mazarin. This is going to be two inhibitors down, though. SKT with a massive lead.
Massive lead. I'm not sure if Gaming Gear can even think about going for the fight again. Taunt comes down onto Deadly Brother, and with that regen that they're grabbing from that Baron buff right now, they're leaving the base with only Faker remotely low from that last engagement.
They're going to rotate over to the top here. They feel like doing it by the clear out every single lane. Faker's going to go spend his... Oh, it's only 900 gold there. So they're actually not going to get a whole bunch by him basing. He goes back for home guards. Was that the upgrade he just purchased?
Yes. Home guards picked up there. Which
they don't actually need that at this point.
Not particularly, but he's full health now at least when he comes back into the action. You can see that all those pink wards down and wards giving him complete vision control over Gaming Gear's base with that Baron still running on them. Not too much time left on it though. Gaming Gear have slowly but surely lost a big portion of that base. Only now, the one turret still left
Faker,
in that top lane.
Faker isn't with the rest of the team right now, and Gaming Gear are kind of at that point where they're like a caged animal. They know they don't have much hope left, so they'll make a reckless move right now. And they will go for this Bengi Piglet duo that's standing up by the turret. It's one of the only moves that they really have left, is hoping for a Mazarin ulti, someone by themselves into turret, and capitalizing very quickly. Other than that, it's really SKT just pushing in for the win.
Well, at this stage, that Baron buff has now run out. Deadly Brother trying his best to spam his abilities and get them away from those Nexus turrets. The final final inhibitor turret will be focused and finish off. There is impact going in. Stranglethorn's knocked two of them up. They're not going to escape from that one. Now they go on towards Mazarine. He heads back off towards the fountain, and MBS becomes the focus. But they're going to go in towards these Nexus turrets. The first one going to go down. Alanir goes straight in there. They pick one kill up, but they're probably going to pay the price of the rest of them for this one. NBS using his passive there to stay alive for a little longer. Mazarine, though, the only man left alive. They're diving him here right underneath the fountain. There's a last second
zone from Baker.
He does go. No, he doesn't die in the end. Just about survives. SKT finish off the Nexus and the game. Brilliant performance. They picked themselves back up.
Yeah, that was a very clean little initiate there by Mandu at the end. But SKT really, after the mid-game team fight there, where Gaming Gear basically forced the issue themselves, after SKT1 got that lead, they never let it go.
Yeah, not making too much hard work of it, I think. And see that shake of hands between these two teams. Very respectful. Sportsmanlike behavior, as you would have come to expect at this stage of things. And now, Gaming Gear, that's another loss for them. Mazarine still got a smile on his face at this point of things. And we talked about this yesterday, that for the likes of Gaming Gear and Maness, who don't have really any major stage experience, even if they were to come here and end up losing every game, the experience is something that they can use moving forward to when you look towards Season 4 even.
Yeah, these guys do have a really good attitude about it. And they are increasing incrementally in skill level. They're getting off some very good mid-game team fights against these world-class teams. So this is literally the best practice that you can ever have in League of Legends.
Well, another big win there for SKT T1. We're going to head over to Riv and the crew for a breakdown of that dominating win.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. And it's actually one of the games that we kind of thought would go the way it did, coming out of champion or coming out of picks and bans for their champions. It was really something different actually coming in for Faker that we noticed is that Fizz pickup.
Yeah, and this is really a testament to SK Telecom's versatility here, because actually that's the first time Faker has ever played Fizz in a professional match, and that is his 19th different champion in 51 professional games. So that gives you some idea of the scope of his champion pool. And it's also only the third game that Piglet has ever played on Ezreal. So they're trying to mix it up here, trying to get some different strategies in, and I think that's a good sign.
It really surprises me that he would pick something new and show it against Gaming Gear that, like, other teams in the group are going to pick up on, oh, he plays Fizz. But at the same time, I think he might be just be flaunting his huge champion pool, being like, I'm Faker, I play everything, and I'm good at everything.
I just think it's the opposite. If you have a chance, if you get into a game where you're top favorite to win and you have a little bit of leeway, let's face it, they're outclassing the other
team.
I'd agree
with that.
With all respect to Gaming Gear, you cannot like discredit that SKT1 is a giant compared to them. And this gives you a little bit of leeway to try new champions, still at a world-class level in front of the crowd, like the same setting, just to introduce something new.
But not only that, I think it's actually good to use it because at this point you're saying, hey, look what Faker can play, and you may not have thought it's a threat before. That's another ban that Faker can absorb right now, and I think it goes further in the mind games that way.
Yeah, specifically with the Ahri Fizz play we've been seeing so much of and people trying to pick Fizz against Ahri, even though it hasn't been scaring people off the counter pick as well, it could just be another thing that adds to Faker's repertoire.
And one more thing about that game with these picks, with the definitive win that was found, it was a slow start there for SKT. They kind of put their hard hats on before really going full force.
I think at the beginning we still saw SK Telecom being a little shaky in that game. They were over-aggressive at times. But really, when it came to that dragon fight, you could see how well Kobe was talking about the power spike that they got with Trinity Force and Lich Bane. They knew it was a great time to fight. And not only that, but their team fighting was virtually immaculate. When they came in with the Assault and Battery, it chained perfectly into Vault Breaker, then into Shentaunt, then into Zyra. And so that chain CC, that's what we expect from SK Telecom. And that's what allowed them to take the dragon and four kills, and Gaming Gear got absolutely nothing in return.
All right, so with that game, now let's take a look at the Group A standings. With their win, SKT has taken control of second place.